I'm going to tell you two things today. One is what we have lost, and two, a way to bring it back. And let me start with this. This is my baseline. This is the Mediterranean coast with no fish, bare rock, and lots of sea urchins that like to eat the algae. Something like this is what I first saw when I jumped in the water for the first time in the Mediterranean coast of Spain. Now, if an alien came to Earth, let's call him Joe, what would Joe see? If Joe jumped in a coral reef, there are many things the alien could see. Very unlikely Joe would jump on a pristine coral reef, a virgin coral reef with lots of corals, sharks, crocodiles, manatees, groupers, turtles, etc. So probably what Joe would see would be in this part, on the greenish part of the picture. Here we have the extreme with dead corals, microbial soup, and jellyfish. And where the diver is, you know, this is probably where most of the reefs of the world are now, with very few corals, algae overgrowing the corals, lots of bacteria, and where the large animals are gone. And this is what most marine scientists have seen too. This is their baseline. This is what they think is natural, because we started modern science with scuba diving long after we started degrading marine ecosystems. So I'm going to get us all on a time machine, and we're going to go to the left. We're going to go back to the past to see what the ocean was like. And let's start with this time machine, the Line Islands, where we have conducted a series of National Geographic expeditions. This is an archipelago belonging to Kiribati that spans across the equator, and it has several uninhabited, unfished, pristine islands and a few inhabited islands. So let's start with the first one, Christmas Island, over 5,000 people. Most of the reefs are dead, most of the corals are dead, overgrown by algae. And most of the fishes are smaller than the pencils that we use to count them. We did 250 hours of diving here in 2005. We didn't see a single shark. This is the place that Captain Cook discovered in 1777, and he described huge abundance of sharks biting the rudders and the oars of their small boats while they were going ashore. Let's move the dial a little bit to the past. Fanning Island, 2,500 people. The corals are doing better here. Lots of small fish. This is what many divers would consider paradise. This is what you can see in most of the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary. And many people think this is really, really beautiful, if this is your baseline. If we go back to a place like Palmyra Atoll, where I was with Jeremy Jackson a few years ago, the corals are doing better, and there are sharks. You can see sharks in every single dive. And this is something that is very unusual in today's coral reefs. But then if we shift the dial 200, 500 years back, then we get to the places where the corals are absolutely healthy and gorgeous, forming spectacular structures, and where the predators are the most conspicuous thing, where you see between 25 and 50 sharks per dive. What have we learned from these places? Well, this is what we thought was natural. This is what we call the biomass pyramid. If we get all of the fishes of a coral reef together and weigh them, this is what we would expect. Most of the biomass is low in the food chain, the herbivores, the parrotfish, surgeon fishes that eat the algae. Then the plankton feeders, these little damselfish that eat the little animals floating in the water. And then we have a lower biomass of carnivores and a lower biomass of top predators, the sharks, the large snappers, the large groupers. But this is a consequence. This view of the world is a consequence of having studied degraded reefs. When we went to pristine reefs, we realized that the natural world was upside down. This pyramid was inverted. The top predators account for most of the biomass, in some places up to 85%, like Kingman Reef, which is now protected. The good news is that in addition to having more predators, there's more of everything. The size of these boxes is bigger. We have more sharks, more biomass of snappers, more biomass of herbivores too, like this parrotfish, that are like marine goats. They clean the reef. Everything that grows enough to be seen, they eat, and they keep the reef clean and allow the corals to replenish. Not only these places, these ancient pristine places, have lots of fish, but they also have other important components of the ecosystem, like the giant clams, pavements of giant clams in the lagoons, up to 20, 25 per square meter. These have disappeared from every inhabited reef in the world, and they filter the water. They keep the water clean from microbes and pathogens. But still, now we have global warming. You know, if we don't have fishing, because these reefs are protected by law or by their remoteness, this is great, but the water gets warmer for too long and the corals die. So how are these fish, these predators, going to help? Well, what we have seen is that in this particular area, during El Niño year, 97-98, the water was too warm for too long, and many corals bleached, and many died. In Christmas, where the food web is really trimmed down, where the large animals are gone, the corals have not recovered. In Fanning Island, the corals are not recovered, but you see here a big table coral that died and collapsed, and the fish have grazed the algae, so the turf of algae is a little lower. Then you go to Palmyra Atoll, that has more biomass of herbivores, and the dead corals are clean, and the corals are coming back. And when you go to the pristine site, did this ever bleached? Now, this place is bleached too, but they recover faster. The more intact, the more complete, the more complex is your food web, the higher the resilience, the more likely that the system is going to recover from the short-term impacts of warming events. And that's good news. So we need to recover that structure. We need to make sure that all of the pieces of the ecosystem are there, so the ecosystem can adapt to the effects of global warming. So if we have to reset the baseline, if we have to push the ecosystem back to the left, how can we do it? Well, there are several ways. One very clear way is the marine protected areas, especially no-take reserves that we set aside to allow for the recovery of marine life. And let me go back to that image of the Mediterranean. This was my baseline. This is what I saw when I was a kid. And at the same time, I was watching Jacques Cousteau's shows on TV with all this richness and abundance and diversity. And I thought that this richness belonged to tropical seas and that the Mediterranean was a naturally poor sea. But little I know until I jumped for the first time in a marine reserve. And this is what I saw. Lots of fish. After a few years, between 5 and 7 years, the fishes come back, they eat the urchins, and then the algae grow again. So you have this little algal forest, and in this the size of a laptop, you can find more than 100 species of algae, mostly microscopic, feed hundreds of species of little animals that then feed the fish. So the system recovers. And this particular place, the Medas Islands Marine Reserve, is only 94 hectares, and it brings 6 million euros to the local economy. 20 times more than fishing. And it represents 88% of all the tourist revenue. So these places not only help the ecosystem, but also help the people who can benefit from the ecosystem. So let me just give you a summary of what no-take reserves do, these places. When we protect them, if we compare them to unprotected areas nearby, this is what happens. The number of species increases 21%. So if you have 1,000 species, you would expect 200 more in a marine reserve. This is very substantial. The size of organisms increases a third. So your fish are now this big. The abundance, how many fish per square meter you have, increases almost 170%. And the biomass, this is the most spectacular change, 4.5 times greater biomass on average, just after 5-7 years. In some places, up to 10 times larger biomass inside the reserves. So we have all these things inside the reserve that grow, and what do they do? Well, they reproduce. That's population biology 101. If you don't kill the fish, they take a longer time to die, they grow larger, and they reproduce a lot. And same thing for invertebrates. This is the example. These are egg cases laid by a snail off the coast of Chile. And this is how many eggs they lay on the bottom. Outside the reserve, you cannot even detect this. 1.3 million eggs per square meter inside the marine reserve, where these snails are very abundant. So these organisms reproduce, the little larvae, juveniles, spill over, the adults spill over, and then people can benefit from them outside too. This is in the Bahamas, Nassau grouper. Huge abundance of groupers inside the reserve. And the closer you get to the reserve, the more fish you have. So the fishermen are catching more. You can see where the limits of the reserve are because you see the boats lined up. So there is a spillover. There are benefits beyond the boundaries of this reserve that help people around them, while at the same time, the reserve is protecting the entire habitat. It is building resilience. So what we have now or a world without reserves is like a debit account where we withdraw all the time and we never make any deposit. Reserves are like savings accounts. We have this principle that we don't touch that produces returns, social, economic, and ecological. And if we think about the increase of biomass inside the reserve, this is like compound interest. Two examples, again, of how these reserves can benefit people. This is how much fishermen get every day in Kenya, fishing over a series of years in a place where there is no protection. It's free for all. Once the most degrading fishing gear, seine nets, were removed, the fishermen were catching more. If you fish less, you're actually catching more. But if we add a no-take reserve on top of that, the fishermen are still making more money by fishing less around an area that is protected. Another example, Nassau groupers in Belize, in the Mesoamerican Reef. This is grouper sex. The groupers aggregate around the full moons of December and January for a week. They used to aggregate up to the 30,000 groupers about this big in 1 hectare, in 1 aggregation. Fishermen knew about these things, they caught them, and they depleted them. When I went there for the first time in 2000, there were only 3,000 groupers left. And the fishermen were authorized to catch 30% of the entire spawning population every year. So we did a simple analysis, and it doesn't take rocket science to figure out that if you take 30% every year, your fishery is going to collapse very quickly. And with the fishery, the entire reproductive ability of the species goes extinct. It happened in many places around the Caribbean. And they would make $4,000 per year, total, for the entire fishery, several fishing boats. Now, if you do an economic analysis and project what would happen if the fish were not caught, if we brought just 20 divers 1 month per year, the revenue would be more than 20 times higher, and that would be sustainable over time. So how much of this we have? If this is so good, if this is such a no-brainer, how much of this we have? And you already heard that less than 1% of the ocean is protected. We're getting closer to 1% now, thanks to the protection of the Chagos Archipelago. And only a fraction of this is fully protected from fishing. Scientific studies recommend that at least 20% of the ocean should be protected. The estimates range between 20 and 50% for a series of goals of biodiversity and fisheries enhancement and resilience. Now, is this possible? How much, people would ask, how much would that cost? Well, let's think about how much we are paying now to subsidize fishing. $35 billion per year. Many of these subsidies go to destructive fishing practices. Well, there are a couple estimates of how much would it cost to create a network of protected areas covering 20% of the ocean. That would be only a fraction of what we are now paying, you know, the government hands out to a fishery that is collapsing. People are losing their jobs because the fisheries are collapsing. A creation of a network of reserves would provide direct employment for more than 1 million people, plus all the secondary jobs and all the secondary benefits. So how can we do that? If it's so clear that these savings accounts are good for the environment and for people, why don't we have 20, 50% of the ocean? And how can we reach to that goal? Well, there are two ways of getting there. The trivial solution is to create really large protected areas like the Chagos Archipelago. The problem is that we can create these large reserves only in places where there are no people, where there is no social conflict, where the political cost is really low, and the economic cost is also low. And a few of us, a few organizations in this room and elsewhere are working on this, but what about the rest of the coast of the world where people live and make a living out of fishing? Well, there are three main reasons why we don't have tens of thousands of small reserves. The first one is that people have no idea what marine reserves do. And fishermen tend to be really, really defensive when it comes to regulating or closing an area, even if it's small. Second, the governance is not right because most coastal communities around the world don't have the authority to manage the resources, to create a reserve and enforce it. It's a top-down hierarchical structure where people wait for government agents to come, and this is not effective, and the government don't have enough resources, which takes us to the third reason why we don't have many more reserves, is that the funding models have been wrong. NGOs or government spend a lot of time and energy and resources in a few small areas, usually. So marine conservation, coastal protection, has become a sink for government or philanthropic money, and this is not sustainable. So the solutions are just fixing these three issues. First, we need to develop a global awareness campaign to inspire local communities and governments to create no-take reserves that are better than what we have now. It's the savings account versus the debit account with no deposits. Second, we need to redesign the governance so conservation efforts can be decentralized. So conservation efforts don't depend on work from NGOs or from government agencies and can be created by the local communities, like it happens in the Philippines and other and a few places. And third, and very important, we need to develop new business models. The philanthropy sink as the only way to create reserves is not sustainable. We really need to develop models, business models, where conservation, coastal conservation, is an investment. Because we already know that these marine reserves provide social, ecological, and economic benefits. And I'd like to finish with one thought, which is that no one organization alone is going to save the ocean. There has been a lot of competition in the past, and we need to develop a new model of partnership, truly collaborative, where we are looking for complementing, not substituting. The stakes are just too high to continue the way we are going. So let's do that. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Henri.
Thank you.
So, that was a masterful job of pulling things together. First of all, just your pyramid, your inverted pyramid, showing 85% of the biomass and the predators. That seems impossible. How could 85% survive on 15%?
Well, imagine that you have two gears of a watch, big one and a small one. The big one is moving very slowly, and the small one is moving fast. That's basically it. The animals at the lower parts of the food chain, they reproduce really fast, they grow really fast, they produce millions of eggs. Up there you have sharks and large fish that live 25, 30 years. They reproduce very slowly, they have a slow metabolism, and basically they just maintain their biomass. So basically the production surplus of these guys down there is enough to maintain this biomass there that is not moving. They are like capacitors of the system.
That's really fascinating. So really, our picture of a food pyramid is just, we have to change that completely.
At least in the sea, this what we found on coral reefs is that the inverted pyramid is the equivalent of the Serengeti with five lions per wildebeest. And on land, this cannot work. But at least on coral reefs or systems where there is a bottom component or the structure, we think that this is universal. But we have started studying pristine reefs only very recently.
So the numbers you presented really are astonishing. You're saying we're spending $35 billion now on subsidies. It would only cost $16 billion to set up 20% of the ocean as marine protected areas that actually give new living choices to the fishermen as well. If the world was a smarter place, we could solve this problem for negative $19 billion. We've got $19 billion to spend on healthcare or something.
And then we have the underperformance of fisheries that is $50 billion. So again, one of the big solutions is have the World Trade Organization shifting the subsidies to sustainable practices.
Okay, so there's a lot of excitement that I'm hearing out there about ending the subsidies madness. So thank you for those numbers. The last one's a personal question. You know, a lot of the experience of people here who've been in the oceans for a long time has just been seeing this degradation, the places they saw that were beautiful, getting worse, depressing. Talk to me about the feeling that you must have experienced of going to these pristine areas and seeing things coming back.
It is a spiritual experience. We go there to try to understand the ecosystem, to try to measure, count fish and sharks, and see how these places are different from the places we know. But the best feeling is this biophilia that E.O. Wilson talks about, where humans have this sense of awe and wonder in front of untamed nature, of raw nature. And there, only there, you really feel that you are part of a larger thing or of a larger global ecosystem. And if it were not for these places that show hope, I don't think I could continue doing this job. It would be just too depressing.
Well, Enric, thank you so much for sharing some of that spiritual experience with us all. Thank you.
Thank you very much.